Hello, welcome to This Orange Couch. My name is Kate. I'm a knitter coming to you from North Carolina, and this is just my knitting show where I talk about what I finished and what I'm working on and what I will be working on next. This is the seventh or eighth time I've tried to start this episode, and there's just been a lot of interruptions and nonsense. So we'll see how it goes. I have three finished objects to show you, which is very exciting. I have two works in progress, both of which I'm super pleased with. One needle adjacent project, something I think I'm going to work on next, and then a little bit of life chatter. So all the stuff I talk about and my socials are in the box below. So let's just get started. The first thing that I can talk to you about is what I'm wearing, which is the Twist Tee by Nina Ruth. I knit this last summer, I think around July. And it's like really cute. It's an Aran weight cotton tee. I knit it out of Lana Grossa Cool Cotton, which is a cotton polyester, I think, or nylon blend to give it a little bit of elastic. And I really like how the shape looks on me. I think it's really flattering, and I like this little twist and how it pulls in. And yeah, so that is the Twist Tee by Nina Ruth, and it definitely goes with my couch. As does one of my other finished objects. I'm really into orange lately. Okay, so that's done. First finished object, which I have been working on forever, is the Jenny Jacket by PetiteKnit. Oh my word, this was so much work. Okay, the Jenny Jacket by PetiteKnit, which is a worsted weight cardigan, although I knit it with the intention of it being like a jacket, like outerwear. And it is heavy and dense and thick and super warm, which is why I have not actually worn it since I finished it. So I knit it out of Knit Picks Brava worsted in the Almond colorway. I really like this color for this. I feel like this, it's pretty similar to this sample. You know, every once in a while you knit something and the color that the designer used is just like exactly perfect. And so that was the case here. So I used the Almond colorway, really pretty. And it is a pretty basic construction, just a bottom up raglan cardigan. There's no steeks or anything. It's just knit like back and forth, like most cardigans I've knit. But the special thing is this stitch patterning, the smocking stitch patterning, which is all over. And so this took forever. Most of the patterning is 2x2 rib, right? And so that doesn't take too long. I feel like I can do 2x2 rib pretty quickly. But every sixth row has this gather, right? And so you have to like put the stitches in, you know, like six stitches down and pull a loop through and then knit that together. And so that is so tedious. It takes so long to do that. But it turns out really beautiful. And then it was extra fiddly when, so in the round, I didn't have this problem. When I was knitting the sleeve in the round, I wasn't having any issue with getting the smocking stitch patterning to look good. Baby Collie, I think now is not a great time to play. Dear. But when I was knitting it flat, which you may be able to see a little bit of the problem, but these stitches, like the first stitch of the gather was loose, like really, really loose. And on the bottom especially, you can see it, because I think this was before I figured out how to fix it. So these really loose stitches did not look great. And I was not sure how to fix it. Like I tried undoing it and pulling it really tight and nothing was working. And so what I ended up doing, in case you are trying to do a smocking patterning and you're finding that you have this really loose stitch, essentially what I did was on the following right side row, so I would purl, or I mean not purl back because it's 2x2 rib, but I would do the wrong side all the way back And then on the following row, I don't know if you can even see it from the other side. I don't think that you can. But essentially what I would do is on the following row, there would be that loose stitch, and then there's another stitch right above it. And so what I would do is I would take that back loop of the loose stitch and pull it up and twist it and put it on my needle and then knit the two stitches together. And that tightened it right up. And so you can still tell that it doesn't look exactly correct on the fabric. Like it's still a little bit loose on that part, but I think from a distance especially, it's not really noticeable anymore, which is great. So yeah, that's what I did to fix it. Yeah, I didn't make any modifications. I knit the size 2XL, which is a little bit bigger than I think I would have done if I was intending to wear this as a regular cardigan, but I knew that this was going to be so warm that I would want to use it as outerwear, and so I wanted to make sure that I could, like, other clothes would fit underneath it. And so I knit the 2XL, which the sleeves still fit pretty tightly, but the body, like, doesn't, the smocking pattern doesn't stretch out as much over the body, but if I'm wearing it over other layers, then maybe it would. So anyway, knit the 2XL for some positive ease. I didn't make any modifications. Normally I crop almost everything unless it's already cropped, just because I am a skirt and dress wearer, and, like full length sweaters tend to look weird with skirts and dresses. So, but I didn't do it on this one again because it's intended to be outerwear. So as you could have probably seen in the pictures that I posted, it definitely goes like all the way to my butt, which is not usually a silhouette that I do, but I really like how it turned out. The edging of the button band has the Italian sewn bind off that a lot of this designer's patterns have. I don't know if I said who the designer was because I'm all over the place today. PetiteKnit. This is a PetiteKnit design if I didn't already say that. Anyway, the cast off is the Italian sewn bind off, which takes a really long time, but I think it ends up looking really clean and tidy and nice. So I'm pretty pleased with it. So, despite this being huge and heavy and using a ton of yarn, it still is a budget knit, which is great. So the buttons, yarn, and pattern altogether were $29.11. Very affordable for such a large and intricate garment. And I'm really hoping that it'll serve me well, especially given that I don't think I'm going to get a ton of wear out of it, because it will be like a coat. And it's been too warm to wear it at all since I finished it. Yeah. I got the buttons from Supplies Sundry on Etsy, which is where I often get buttons. There's a link if you are looking for a online button supplier. So yeah, there we go. Here's the bottom. It's so cute. It turned out so well, and it looks so much more challenging than it is. When I posted it on Reddit, a lot of people were asking how hard it was to knit, and I really don't think it's as technically challenging as it might look. Like, if you have knit a raglan sweater before and you know how to do 2x2 rib, you can knit this sweater. It really is not that technically challenging. It's just tedious. Like, and I imagine that if you're a slower knitter, it would take a ton of time to finish. I mean, it took me like 2 months to do, which is a long time for me. So yeah, it's not super challenging, but it is a lot of work. So there's that. But I am really, really happy with it. And I love the color. I love the color that I chose. I don't normally wear things that are this color, although I have another work in progress that I'll show you that is similar in shade. So maybe I'm starting to be attracted to the beiges. I know beige is kind of like I don't know if it's in, but it's, I don't know, beige is a color that I think is associated with, like, a sort of refined, elegant type of dresser, which I don't know if that is me, but anyway, I like this sweater, and I'm happy that I knit it. I think that's all I have to say about it. Okay, great. Super comfy, cozy. All right. It is so thick. Ridiculously thick. I mean, look at that. When I fold it up, it's just a lot of sweater. Okay. All right. My second finished object is orange. So I'll try to show it to you, but it might just blend in with all the rest of the orange in my life. It is a Fabel knitwear pattern. Are you surprised? You shouldn't be. This is the third one that I've knit from Fabel knitwear. Like I said before, I am simply obsessed with everything that she's ever designed. I want to knit everything. I want to knit her whole book. Anyway, this one is one of her older patterns. It is the Burrow cardigan. So cute. I mean, it's pretty basic. It is a bottom-up V-neck raglan cardigan. But the yarn that I used for it is unusually nice. I usually knit with quite budget yarns, but this was a gift from my parents for my birthday. They came to South Carolina, but they did visit me in North Carolina for a couple of days. And we went to a local yarn shop. Well, they sell fabric too. A local, like, fabric yarn shop. Anyway, called Freeman's Creative. I recommend it to any triangle area vegan knitters or other knitters. I don't know. I didn't look at their, like, wool selection. But the thing that stuck out to me was that they have a huge selection of plant yarn, which sometimes is hard. Like, I've been into yarn shops where they had basically nothing that was not an animal fiber. And so if you are looking for that in a local yarn shop in the Triangle area, I recommend Freeman's Creative. So we went there, and I picked out this yarn among some other yarns. And it is called Mirasol Usun, and this is the Sunstone colorway. And it is a beautiful chainette construction, or ply, chainette ply, is that how you would say that? Cotton with a little bit of polyester nylon something to give it a little bit of strength. The yarn, or the cotton, is organic cotton from Peru. Incredibly soft. So ridiculously soft. I have not knit with cotton this soft before. Oh, it's so nice. And I really love the chainette. I feel like it makes the texture of this fabric just absolutely beautiful. It has a lot of drape, which I know the pattern doesn't really, the sample didn't really have like a really drapey yarn. So I am glad that it worked out and it wasn't too drapey, but when it's on the body, it looks great. It looks so good. I really like the sleeve. It's got like just a tiny little bit of a bishop sleeve, like just a little bit, which for some reason, I talked about this last time, for some reason I feel like I have to have fitted sleeves because I'm kind of chubby, and like if I have, I don't know, I feel like it's burned into my brain the idea that you have to, if you make certain parts of your body look thick and the rest of your body looks thick, then the whole body looks thick. But the thing is, like, my body is kind of thick and that's fine. So anyway, this sleeve is beautiful and I'm glad that I knit it. I don't know if I'll ever be like a bell sleeve kind of babe, but anyway, gorgeous. I knit the 2XL, and I also added extra increases. When I knit up the torso, I added extra increases on the side to accommodate my bust, and I will talk about that a little bit more because I've gotten questions about it. So
as you may be able to see right here, so I have increases that are spaced out a little bit more at the bottom, and these are the increases that are called for. There are children outside that are experiencing a lot of joy right now, so I apologize if their sounds are bothering you, but it is what it is. So anyway, I have these increases here. These are the ones that are called for. I think they go up to about here, right? Evenly spaced. And then I decided that I was going to do two more sets of increases, and this is right at where my bust sort of increases, right? Like, it rapidly increases in size right there. And so I added two more sets of increases, and I did them very close together, because that's how my body is shaped. Like, I increase gradually, but then when my bust is really increasing, like, it does it quickly. And so I added those extra ones right there. And then a few rows before I got to the, here is the seam under the armpit. So hopefully I can show this to you. It's harder to see decreases, I think, compared to increases. But a few rows before the sleeve is joined, I did two sets of decreases to get those out. So I have extra increases here, and then I decrease them out right at the underarm, just so I don't have a bunch of extra fabric at my upper bust. So yeah, that's how I added extra increases in here. Obviously, that does not produce as great of a fit as it would if there were sort of like front and back increases, decreases, or bust starts. But given that this is a positive ease garment anyway, I think it works fine. Yeah, I think it looks good. So yeah, and then the other modification that I made was I widened the collar and button band. It is probably 3/4 to 2/3 of this size in the pattern, but I had these buttons that I thought looked really, really good with this color, and so I wanted to use them, and so I needed a bigger button band to accommodate them. Plus, it looked like the really narrow button band, because this is sort of a wide V-neck, it looked like the narrow button band might slip off the shoulders a little bit, and I didn't want that to happen. So I just increased the size. This is knit all in one go. The button bands and collar are all just like one bit, and so I just did extra rows there to accommodate. So there we go. I think those are the only modifications that I made. But yeah. Oh, I love this sweater. I'm almost a little bit afraid to wear it because it is so nice, and it's not the kind of, I don't normally wear things that are this nice or knit with fibers this nice, so I'm like afraid to ruin it. But I did wear it out. I had lunch with my PhD program advisor and two of his other students, and I did wear this sweater to that lunch, and it kept me warmer than I thought. Like, cotton, usually I don't associate it with being a warm garment, but I feel like because it's so fluffy, maybe it traps more air in the fibers compared to something like this, which is really tightly plied. I don't know. Maybe it's just the nylon content. I don't think it's just the nylon content, but anyway, it's so beautiful and lovely, and I am so grateful to my parents for buying me such nice yarn, because I don't normally knit with such nice yarn. Oh, it's so pretty. I really like it. So, once again, another successful garment from Fabel Knitwear. I just really like the shapes that she designs. I think that they are flattering for my body. I always have to modify them to add, because they're intended to be close fitting. And she has increases like for waist to bust ratio, but it is simply not enough for me. So I always have to modify them a little bit, but it's not that big of a deal. So I really like her patterns. Anyway, sorry this is turning into just like a Fabel Knitwear fangirl channel. It's not what I'm trying to do. Anyway,
There we go. The Burrow cardigan. Super pretty. I just want to keep touching it forever. It's so nice. Okay, let me make sure that I didn't miss anything on this. I did not. Great. All right. I want to knit with this again, this yarn. But it's expensive. Ooh. Maybe I will have another opportunity later in life. Although sometimes I see a yarn that I want, or I want to knit with a yarn that I've knit before, and then I go online to find it, and it has disappeared forever, never to return. And I'm just like, this is really not good for my desire to acquire yarn just in case. Because, you know, I always feel like, oh, well, it'll be there. Just resist the urge. It'll be there when you really want it. But then sometimes it's not. Sometimes it isn't there later. And that sucks. Sorry, I'm not trying to encourage excessive consumerism on this channel. Just talking about my feelings. Anyway, my last finished object was definitely a quick knit. I whipped it up pretty quickly. It is the Librarian Vest by Skeindeer Knits. Also a designer that I've knit a lot of. I think this is my third garment from Skeindeer Knits. But I also knit a pair of her mittens, so this is the fourth thing that I've knit from her. She's also Norwegian. Fabel Knitwear and Skeindeer are both Norwegian, although Skeindeer lives in London. But anyway, this vest, super fast to work up. Even though it has this stitch pattern, it's just like twisted stitches, so it's not even like you need a cable needle or to move the stitches around or anything like that. Like, it's just a twisted stitch, so it's really, really easy to do. And it's knit in a worsted weight, and so it knits up really, really quickly. So this is let's see, so I knit the size 4 without any modifications on, like, intentional modifications. I think that my ribbing is longer than it's supposed to be, but anyway, no intentional modifications. So I knit the size 4, so it does look small, but I did want it to have negative ease, because when I was looking at the projects, I really liked how it looked when it had negative ease, especially on a larger bust person, and I thought it would look cute and hot, and it does. So yeah, I really like how the shape of it turned out on me. I think it's really, really cute and flattering and, like, a little sexy librarian, which is nice. I don't have a lot of garments that go with vests yet, but I am hoping to add some soon, because my boyfriend is coming here for spring break, and he will be bringing the sewing machine that he bought for me that he accidentally had delivered to his house instead of mine. And I was like, don't worry about it, just bring it next time you come here, and he is coming here and bringing it. So I would like to sew blouses and or dresses that have, like, maybe a collar or a ruffle and some sleeves that would go really nicely underneath a vest. I do have one, like, collared shirt that I wear with these, or two collared shirts. I have two collared shirts. One of them, though, like the one that I wore in the pictures, it does not fit me very well at all, and I had to, like, constantly pull it in place to. And so I don't think I would actually wear that with this, because the shoulders and sleeves are so tight. It's really not great. It was cute for the modeling. Anyway, but I have another collared shirt that fits well. But I do want to add more things to wear with vests, because I think vests are a great garment item for living in the South, right? When it's, like, just a little bit cold. Where you want, like, a cotton long sleeve or elbow length sleeve is fine, but then, you know, you want to protect your body a little bit from the cold and the wind. Sweater vest, perfect. So I really want more of them and to wear them. But anyway, I knit this out of Lion Brand Heartland in the Mammoth Cave. which is one of my favorite grays. I love a warm gray that's like a little bit brown. Beautiful gray color. I really like Lion Brand Heartland. I think it's a 100% acrylic. It's inexpensive, but it's not ultra budget. So it's softer and it has a little bit of heathering, I think, which gives it like a nicer depth of color. So anyway, I really like it. But this is still a budget knit because it uses so little yarn. Like, this is two balls of yarn. It's really quick. Anyway, so I think the yarn and the pattern together were $18.20. Plus, it's super quick to knit. So, really, really happy with it. I started it. I knit almost all of it, except for the neckband and the finishing on the armholes, right? I had it like almost done, and then I got super distracted by my work in progress, and I just like didn't do it forever, for like a week. And I kept being like, I just need to finish it, I just need to finish it. But I was so distracted by my work in progress that I will talk about now. You'll understand why I got so distracted. It's so fun to knit. Okay. All right. Works in progress now. The first one that I'm going to talk about, which is the one that was so distracting. Collie, you scratched my finger and it hurt really bad. Please be nice. She's underneath the couch right now, which is very exciting, right? Okay. I reached down and she was like, ooh, scary monster. Anyway. The first work in progress that I'm going to show you is the Tsubaki Pullover by Hiroko Fukatsu. Oh, man. Look at that. Okay. So this design is so fascinating to me, right? Because it is, I have been really interested in different methods of shoulder construction because I have interesting proportions, which causes sometimes like shoulders to fit weird. Like, I think raglans fit me kind of funny because of my bust size, and I get like a little bit of extra fabric on the upper bust sometimes, which like is fine. I don't mind how it looks, but I have just been intrigued by different alternative shoulder constructions, like saddle shoulders and things like that, just to see how they fit. And so I picked this sweater. The design on it is beautiful. Like, the front is beautiful, but it also markets itself as being 100% contiguous, right? You don't break the yarn at all. It's 100% seamless. You knit it all in one go, which is wild. So I'm just going to walk you through how this works. And I think it's okay. Like, I'm not going to give you enough detail that I think you would be able to figure out how to do it, but just to demonstrate. So you start at the top with the ribbing, as you do, right? And then it did something really clever. When you start doing the short rows on the back, right, to raise the back, when you do those short rows, the pattern also had me cast off, like, I knit the ribbing, and then it had me cast off these stitches right at the front, which I did not understand why I would do that, right? And then I was working the short rows back and forth, right, to raise the back edge there, while I was doing this really interesting, like, so I had to knit this saddle shoulder bit right here first, and so I went back and forth and knit that, right? And then I kept knitting, and I came around to the other side, or I cast this off and then came around to the other side, and then I knit that this back and forth, right? While I was doing that anyway, it's ridiculous. And so then I went back around again, and then it had me pick this back up. And I think that that is genius because, like, these are 16 stitch cables that are really heavy. And I feel like that just extra strong edge right there will help a lot with preventing the sweater from, like, dipping down in the middle. Genius. Anyway, brilliant. Okay, and so then you're in the round again, and you're doing just the saddle shoulder increases, right? Instead of a raglan, you have a saddle shoulder. Until you come to here. And then you switch to doing increases for the sleeves alone. So it like sits really nicely here and then it goes straight down. Okay. And then once you have hit sort of here on your body, then you do some raglan increases. And then, so you're doing this in the round, right? While you're doing the patterning on the front. And so you've done the straight down sleeve increases, and then you've done the raglan increases to the armpit. And then you get to the sleeve. And you keep all of these stitches on the needle, and then you just start knitting back and forth on the sleeve. And you knit back and forth and back and forth and back and forth flat all the way to the edge. You do the ribbing, and then you take the needles that are attached to the body, and then you scoop up all of the edge stitches on either side, and then there's like this zipper stitch thing. There you go. There's the zipper stitch thing that you do to like just seam it all up. So you knit back and forth, and then you get all the stitches, and then you zip it up, and then you're back here, right? I'm so excited about this. And then you're back here, and then you go all the way around, and you do the same thing over here. You knit the sleeve back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, and then you zip it up, and then you're back in the body, and then you knit it in the round all the way down. You never break the yarn. You never put anything on a holder. The whole thing is 100% contiguous. It's wild and so cool. And so you can see why I was so distracted by this, because it is just a blast to knit. It is so creative. And, like, it's not easy, right? Like, this is a challenging garment to construct. But the instructions are clear. There's points in it where, because it's so unusual, you read an instruction and you're just like, what? Like, what is that doing? But if you just follow the instructions, it'll make sense. Just follow the instructions and it'll make sense. But yeah, so anyway, here it is where I am. I now am past all of the really fun construction parts and am now just knitting the body down. But oh my gosh, oh my gosh, look at it. Oh man, it's so pretty. Okay, so I am knitting this out of Lana Grossa Elastico, which is very similar to this yarn, except it is a sport weight instead of an Aran weight. But the ply and the fiber content are the same. And I already know I like this yarn, and I know that it doesn't pill and it's really durable. So that's great. This is the sage green color, which is not a color that I usually knit with. Like, usually the greens that I knit with are sneak preview, like this color. But this is so pretty, and I really like the pairing of this color with this pattern, and I am just so excited. So I am going to crop it, like I usually do. I also don't have enough yarn, I don't think, to knit the entire body. It uses a lot of yarn. The 16 stitch cables are extreme. And last night I was at a gathering with some friends, and I forgot to bring my cable needle, and I was like, I could not knit, or I could find something to help me perform this 16 stitch cable. And someone there found a pipe cleaner, and I folded the pipe cleaner in half and twisted it together, and then like made the edges like secure so they wouldn't like poke. And I managed to do 16 stitch cables with a pipe cleaner. It was really difficult, but I did it. Because I'm addicted to knitting and I can't not do it at any time. So anyway, there we go. Tsubaki pullover. Oh my gosh. It's so amazing. So yeah, I'm really glad I chose a yarn that has some elastic in it, because this is like a heavy pattern, and I think if it was 100% cotton, like, it would be too saggy, but I think that this is working well. It's so cool. I love it a lot. I think that you should try making one. I don't care who you are. As long as you knit, you should try this. It's like a really fun challenge. It's so cool. I love it. Anyway, sorry. I'm rambling on and on. I also saw in the designer's Ravelry like projects that she was working on a cardigan version. And I think one of her prototypes had short sleeves, which I think this, like, thinking about it has two cables instead of three, thinking about sort of this design and the shoulder construction and everything, but like a short sleeve cardigan version, also great. But it's so creative. I have had so much fun knitting on this. So I think I will have it done next time we chat. Especially now that the pattern is pretty much memorized. The 16 stitch cables do take a time. They are hard to knit. But other than that, it goes pretty quickly. So yeah, just working on that. All right. And then the last work in progress that I have is Fabel Knitwear. I'm sorry if you're sick of it, but again, I have this on, this guy to keep it from falling apart, but, anyway, keeping with my interest in interesting shoulder construction, I have cast on the Norma Jean Turtleneck by Fabel Knitwear, which also has interesting shoulder construction. So it's a little hard to show you, but I will do my best. And you can see it. I'll put a picture up. But anyway, so it is a turtleneck, short turtleneck. I will probably wear it most of the time folded down, as shown in the pictures. Anyway, okay, here's the front. So it has a little bit of a turtleneck, and then it has so it's knit from the bottom up. So these are increases, but it produces this sort of seam line right at the top of the shoulders, like that. And then she gives really great instructions on how to modify the stitch counts of the pattern to fit your body, because your shoulder width isn't necessarily related to your body size, and you might be a big person with really narrow shoulders or a small person with really broad shoulders. And so the key to making this garment fit really well is to make sure that the shoulder seam ends like right at your shoulder bone, right? And so based on that pattern, my shoulders are quite narrow for what the rest of my body proportions would be. So anyway, so you knit to that sort of point on your body, and then you do the little puff at the top, right? Lots of increases to do the little sleeve puff, and then you're doing increases just for the sleeve while you're knitting downward to create sort of like that shape with the little poofy. Anyway. But I ended up increasing a lot less on this shoulder line, than was suggested for my body size. And so I've planned out how I'm going to, add in some extra increases as I approach my bust. And then about half of them I will do gradually as I go towards my bust line. And then at the point where I separate for sleeves and add stitches at the underarm, I'm going to add more stitches because that's like where the biggest part of me is anyway. And so I think I'll just add the extra ones there. So there we go. I am knitting this, out of Queensland's collection, Dungarees, which is a really interesting yarn that is spun out of recycled jeans. They spin the recycled jeans with other recycled cotton garments or fibers on the website. It says cotton fibers on the website. Anyway, so this, it is like a really heavy, really textured, very denim-like, because it's made from denim, yarn that has, I don't know if you can see them very well, but it has little bit of little speckles and little like floofies from the other fibers that have been spun in with the recycled jeans. So it's not quite a, tweed, but it is a little bit, like there's just a little bit of flex of other stuff. And so I think it's a really interesting looking yarn. It is one that I also got for my birthday at Freeman's Creative. Gift yarn will be showing up more as I knit more summer garments, because for my birthday, I bought mostly summer yarn because those are more expensive than winter yarns. Anyway, so I really like how this is turning out. I like the color a lot. I was worried that it would be too close to my skin color and it would look like a bodysuit, but I think it's fine. I think it looks elegant. And so I don't know if I have enough yarn to do full length sleeves, but I would be fine with either this length or maybe even elbow length sleeves. But then like most or all most of Fabel Knitwear's garments, it decreases at the waist and is cropped and fitted there. And so that is sort of the shape that it will be. But I have not gotten super far. I am just doing the increases for the sleeves now. But yeah, I really like how this yarn feels. I think it's really nice. So cool. So that's my work in progress. The last thing is needle adjacent. The thing I'm thinking about knitting next is I think I'm going to knit the spring sorrel by Wool and Pine. So I have knit a summer sorrel before, although I did modify it. I liked the neckline and I wanted fingering weight like the summer sorrel, but I wanted it to be long sleeve. So I have a long sleeve summer sorrel in a variegated yarn, and I really like it, and I really like the stitch pattern. Like, it has reverse stockinette and then it has what is called a dip stitch, I think, like that sort of radiate out in the yoke. And it's a really beautiful stitch pattern, but I want a short sleeve cropped spring version in a solid color. So I will be knitting it with Berroco Comfort DK in the, I think this one is called Pine Spruce colorway, which is a, you know, dark forest green. This yarn is incredibly soft. It also has a chainette ply. It is 50% superfine nylon, 50% superfine acrylic. So it'll be warm and it'll be a great dress topper for like those transitional months where it's like a little bit cold, but you don't want long sleeves. So yeah, that is what I think I'm going to knit next. And this yarn is so soft. I've knit socks out of the Comfort Sock from this brand. I've never done anything with the Comfort DK though. So I'm excited to do that. So yeah, that's it. I have already been talking for almost 45 minutes. There was a lot of knitting to cover. So just like life update stuff, I am still in my PhD program and it is hard. I fell behind on my work a little bit because, like, sorry, heavy disclosure time, my abusive ex-partner died, and I was really surprised by the emotional reaction that I had to that. I wasn't expecting to have such a strong emotional reaction to that, because this was, like, many years ago, and, you know, but that happened, and I was a wreck, and it was really hard for me to keep up with my work. Fortunately, my mentors and people were understanding, but I think I am almost caught up with everything, and then there will be spring break, and so I'll have like a little bit of breathing room. I can get ahead a little bit on some stuff and like ease my stress levels. My boyfriend will be here too, which will be really great. So
Yeah, but still just trucking along. I will be in DC at the end of this month. It's March. I will be in DC for a conference at the end of this month as well, which will be fun. I've never been to DC, so looking forward to that. And I'll be taking a train there so I can get plenty of knitting done on the train. I keep saying, like, oh, well, that'll give me time to work. I'm not going to work on the train. I'm going to knit on the train, and I know that. So, anyway, yeah, that'll be fun. I also have started making my own hummus. Sorry, just random topic update for you. I also started making my own hummus, which last year, one of my friends asked me if I ever made hummus. And I said, no, I think that it is dangerous for me to have the power to make an essentially unlimited supply of better tasting hummus than I can get from the store for cheaper. I think that's a dangerous power to have. And I was correct. My mom bought me a food processor for Christmas. So I've been making hummus and eating so much of it. And I put so much garlic in it because I can and I love garlic. And so it's like, it's truly disgusting. It makes me smell awful, but it tastes so good. So what I do is I pop off like 2 cloves of a head of garlic and then I cut off the top and then I like put oil on it and cover it in foil and roast it in the oven. So I roast like most of a head of garlic and then I take the 2 raw cloves and chop them up. And so I get like the pungent of the raw garlic, but also the nice roasted garlic flavor. It's nasty. It makes me smell really bad, but it tastes exceptional. So I'm making a big batch for a potluck tomorrow. I understand that some people will taste it and be like, I don't care. I want some people to know about eating hummus with enough garlic to kill a person in it. Anyway, that's it. I think those are all my updates for you. I'm sorry that I feel like I behaved weird in this podcast. But maybe it's just because I am weird and becoming more comfortable in front of the camera. I guess we'll never know. So I'll see you in a few weeks to a month. More summer knits are coming and sewing. So we'll see how this channel changes as I gain the power to sew other types of garments together. Very fun. All right, I'll see you around. Goodbye.